Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world. Thank you for tuning in to Baylorick TV Boxing Channel. We're here to talk about Price versus Tepper, or Tepper, the fight that just happened in Germany. And as you can tell by the tone in my voice,
good morning.
I'm not a happy camper. Not at all. I'm not a happy man. I'm not a happy boxing fan. If I was a journalist, I wouldn't be a happy journalist. Everything that you could possibly want to go wrong went wrong tonight. And there are a lot of lessons to be learned. Not just from a coaching perspective, not just from a journalistic perspective, not from a fan's perspective, and as well as a managerial perspective. Now, I know there are a lot of people out there tonight that are quite happy to say, David Price, you're a bum, you got no chin, you're a chinless wonder, you need to go back and be a plumber, you need to go back and you need to retire. A lot of people out there are thinking that, a lot of people are speaking that, they're saying those things. And there are a lot of emotional people out there at the moment because the way Price got destroyed tonight. And I can understand that. But what I'm going to do is say what I have to say. And then after I've said it, I'm going to go through the comments. Because if I don't, I will A, sort of get sidetracked, and B, not say the things that are on my heart. So I'm going to say those things first. So please excuse me. I'll say these things first, and then I'll look and, do the normal thing and hear what people are saying. First of all, good evening to everybody that is in the room. I'll just give quick shout-outs. Marky B, Ruben Caddick, Tindy, okay, so I've just said good evening to anybody who's in the room. Forgive me if I don't talk about anybody else in the room at this minute in time. I'm just going to start from how I feel about things and speak from the hip and just speak as I feel as a fan. I don't want to take you back because I want to show you how two-tongued people can be in this sport of boxing. And I want to take you back to a time where David Price was knocking out fighters in the British heavyweight division. I will take you back to a time when David Price was being considered the next best thing since sliced bread. I want to take you back to a time when people sat on the same bench or the same seat and told you, the fans, that David Price was the man to fight Vladimir Klitschko and beat Vladimir Klitschko. And it was the second, it will be the second coming. And there were so many people out there. If you go across Twitter and you go across Facebook and you go across boxing forums, those same people will tell you, we go back 2 years ago before Price fought Tony Thompson. They will tell you straight out that Price was the best thing since sliced bread and they would have nothing more of it. Yet Price had never taken a shot. A big shot. He'd never gone the distance. He'd never been in with any quality operators, but he was the best thing since sliced bread. Okay? And all these people on the bandwagon, jumping on the bandwagon, Price this, Price that, Price this, Price that. David Price is this, David Price is that. Now, I'm really angry tonight, mad, because I want to understand how three defeats on a record determines your career is over. I don't get it. I don't understand it. And I'm mad because there are guys, world champions, that have been knocked out on numerous occasions, come back and won a world title. Now, there's lots of things to look at here. The trainer, the training camp, the tactics, the matchmaking. All of these things need to be taken into consideration. When Price fought Tony Thompson, let's remember, Tony Thompson was ranked, what, two or three in the world? He wasn't beaten by any bums. Price went in and took a big risk against a top level fighter. Had he beaten Tony Thompson, we'd all been raving and ranting, saying he was this, that, and the other. He did. He came unstuck. And from that point onwards, fans have just been, it's just been a downhill about David Price. So, you know, yes, the man has vulnerabilities. That is not what I'm going to sit down and say. He hasn't got vulnerabilities. I'm not going to sit here and tell you, oh, I think David Price has got a great chin, or I think that David Price is, you know, a Superman, or David Price could beat the Klitschko's. I'm not going to sit down and tell you any of that stuff. But what I will do is hit you with some hard facts. When Price got knocked up by Thompson the first fight, let's let him go that far. Let's go back to an interview I did with Tyson Fury. Those people who have followed the Baylorick journey, you know, back when, before we had the Baylorick Boxing Channel and we were doing things live, I want to take you back to an interview I did with Tyson Fury first, who said that David Price hasn't got bottle. That's what Fury said. He said David Price has got no bottle. I did an interview after that to hear what Franny Smith had to say. Franny Smith, the trainer of David Price, said that David Price would walk through Tyson Fury. Do you remember that debate? People were saying, yeah, David Price, it's smash up Tyson Fury. I remember those debates. I remember those discussions. Funnily enough, those same discussions are being had at the moment about Anthony Joshua, the next bandwagon to jump on. He's indestructible. He'll knock this person out. And notice, hasn't taken a punch back in anger yet. Nobody's hitting back on the chin yet. And nobody's taken a decision yet. Nobody's got an inside on him. Nobody's even technically enough to do that. If you look at Thompson, he was technically enough to land the shots. Thompson's no mug. This guy Tepper tonight, oh, he should retire because Tepper knocked him out. Well, okay, I saw Tepper knock out Martin Rogan. I mean, destroyed Martin Rogan around. That's what you do to guys that are over the hill. Tepper did that. Tonight, Tepper closed the range down and showed how a smaller guy, or because Tepper's 6'5", let's remember, how a shorter guy closes the range down, gets inside on a fighter and finishes him off. That's what Tepper showed you tonight, because he had a trainer in his corner that knew what was going on. Now, when Price was knocked out by Thompson in the first fight, they brought in Lennox Lewis. Now, people say it was bad matching at making the first time round, but the same people, remember this, the same people who you're listening to week in and week out were the same people who prepared to throw David Price back in the lion's den against Tony Thompson for the second fight. Remember this. The same people that you're calling pundits, the same people that you're calling experts, were back in the ring again against Thompson. And people were saying, yeah, he's got Lennox Lewis in his corner, bloody, 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 blah. There's some fundamentals here. He got beat again by Thompson. Even Lennox Lewis, when he got beat by Oliver McCall, didn't go straight back in against Oliver McCall. Even when he got knocked up by Rackman, didn't go straight back in against Rackman. Not that I don't think anyway. Or did he? I'm not sure. But my point is this. Someone like David Price needs a mentor. Needs a mentor. And for me, my honest opinion, and I don't care, I'm being honest, Franny Smith may have been good as an amateur coach, but there's nothing to suggest in his record or in the top fights back in, let's go back to the Thompson fight, that Smith had what it took to put a game plan together to beat Tepper tonight. Tepper had a game plan. Price had no game plan. from the first 30 seconds, if you're watching the fight, technically now, where was the left jab? The left jab was just a pushing jab. What's that? You've got, you know, behind all the great fighters in history, the left jab has been key. If you're a big man, you've got to be able to dominate with that left jab. You've got to use the left jab. Even you use that left jab to keep the guy off of you, you're using the left jab. Or you're using the jab to find, make openings. But what Price did within the first 30 seconds was allow Tepper to have the confidence to put his game plan together. It's not like Price stood to step in the ring and said, you know what? I'm going to use my jab. I'm going to keep you at distance, right? I might even blind you with a jab sometimes and throw a right hand down the middle. Right, I'm going to be careful not to throw an uppercut from too far a distance I get countered. I'm going to make sure I don't do that. I'm going to make sure I don't get involved in early exchanges with you and not give you the confidence to come forward and throw your wet leather. No, no, there was no game plan. Just do what you've done against the other guys, David. Just go out there, throw the left jab and bang a right hand over the top. You listen to what Franny was saying in the Thompson fight, the second Thompson fight. Listen to what he was saying in the first Thompson fight. At this point in time, I don't think it's over for David Price. I think he's been badly mismanaged. I mean, a Tepper fight, you could say yes, he needed a Tepper fight. But if you're going to put him in a Tepper fight, then you need to have the training camp and the training behind that to make it happen. And so let's ask the question, where was Tommy Brooks? Because I could see slight changes with Price and Tommy Brooks. Why did he leave the camp? And why did Price go back to Smith? I don't understand that. And I don't understand this thing of sitting as a pundit and saying, oh, it's his last chance saloon, bloody, bloody. I don't have no time for that. I don't want to hear that. Yes, it was a tough opponent before. And to be honest, how good is Tepper? He's unbeaten. If that shot had landed on a Deontay Wilder's chin, he might be a world champion today. So you're ready to slam Price for getting knocked out, but he got beaten by Thompson, who was well-rated, and Tepper, we don't know how good he is. But from what I saw tonight, he was able to close the range down, get inside, and get rid of a big man. For me, that guy's pretty good. You know, Tepper's gone in and fought a guy that's a big puncher. Okay, people say he's chinny, but the reason why Vladimir Klitschko is not getting hit as much is because he had a trainer in there that taught him how to tuck his chin in behind his shoulder. And as much as Vladimir Klitschko's boring and Vladimir Klitschko's this and Vladimir Klitschko's that, Vladimir Klitschko could end up the same way as David Price had he managed to not come in. That's the difference between having a good trainer or world-class trainer or a trainer that knows other trainers or other coaches that can build a team to make you world heavyweight champion. You don't play games with the world heavyweight championship or professional boxing career. You set up a unit that you believe is going to make you world champion. There was nothing in the, as far as I'm concerned, what I saw within David Price and his camp. I said to David Price when he got knocked out by Thompson, he needed to go and get a sports psychologist. I said he needed to get away from England. He did that. But then he took the same mentality and went to Germany with it. So of course you're going to get knocked out. You need a trainer that's going to teach you distance and timing and how to spin and how to tie up and get quality sparring. And he could have said, you know what? Let's hold off the Tepper fight. It's a great chance to get back into Europe. But then Salas may have thought, you know what? We need to find out where David is. If you want to do that, then have the right training camp. Have the right trainer around you. Have a mentor around you. James Alibishir talks about coaches with pads. Coaches with pads. And my feeling is that David Price needed a mentor. He's one of those guys that needs a mentor. If you're okay, you know he's a good on-top fighter. You know that he's a bit suspect around the chin. You know he's a bit vulnerable. You need somebody who's going to embrace him. A trainer's going to embrace him. I'm going to mention a couple of names here that I think would have been good for David Price, at least for his mentality. Number one, and a lot of people might say, well, what's he done so far? Is Peter Fury. Even if You know, even Tyson gets beat by Klitschko, what a lot of people expect it to happen. Some people believe Tyson will beat Klitschko. But if you listen to Peter Fury and you listen to what he's doing with fighters, positivity, there's a way that his fighters are being built up. Look at what he's doing with Peter Fury. He's building his career correctly against meaningful testing opposition. And so therefore, if you look at Price's career and you and all these fans that are getting on the Joshua bandwagon and he's knocking this person out, I'm knocking that person out. It's doing nothing for the development of his career. David Price has learned more in the knockout defeat to Tepper and the fight against Thompson and the 10 rounds he did than he ever would have done knocking guys out in one or two rounds. Yes, it's great for confidence. It doesn't teach you how to fight. It doesn't teach you how to fight. So I don't close the door on David Price. I don't subscribe to, it's the end of Price's career. No. What I subscribe to, it's the end of a coach's boxing career, coaching for David Price. I would have to cut ties with Franny Smith. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. He needs to get a world-class, not coach, mentor. I heard somebody say Adam Booth. Is Adam Booth a mentor for David Price? Why did Price leave Booth? So he needs a mentor. He needs a guy who's going to eat, sleep, and train with him, but is not only professional, but is experienced, knows how to produce world-class champions, knows how to teach distance and timing, knows how to teach a fighter how to hold, how to throw, when to throw an uppercut, when not to throw an uppercut. Price didn't know what to do when he was put under pressure. These are things you learn in a gym, right? And Price is still a big punching heavyweight. And I believe had Price had the right tutelage and the right training and the right mentorship, he could have beaten Tepper tonight. I'm sorry, he could have beaten Tepper tonight. But if you don't put the right preparation in, if you don't have the right trainer, if you don't have the right management, this is what happens. So all those people at the moment, they're jumping and bandwagon and saying, Anthony Joshua's he's going to destroy the heavyweight champion of the world. Anthony Joshua will stop this person. Ask yourself the question. There are similarities between Anthony Joshua and David Price. Joshua too was stopped in the amateurs. So don't think for one second that it can't happen to Anthony Joshua. Don't think because he's a matchroom fighter, it can't happen to Anthony Joshua. Don't think because Eddie Hearn is behind him, it can't happen to Anthony Joshua. He just hasn't fought the level of opposition yet to find out the question whether A, you can take a punch, and B, you can fight against an opponent that closes him down and throws punches back at him. Let me ask you all a question. Would you stick Anthony Joshua in the ring with Tepper tomorrow? Would Al Haymon stick Tepper in the ring with Wilder tomorrow? Tepper has used the fundamentals that he's got to the best of his ability. David Price hasn't used his abilities at all and been destroyed. That's the way I see it. And the British public are lovely. They have a fantastic way of building somebody up, building them up, and then knocking them down. And it's something I cannot stand. I can't stand it. Because a guy loses, you do give up on him. That's not loyalty. That's not a fan. That's a fanatic. As soon as your fighter loses, or that guy loses, you're on the next gravy chain. You ain't loyal. Now, I don't have any personal affiliation to David Price. I don't have a channel dedicated to David Price. It doesn't pay me to say what I'm saying here. But what I'm saying is that, and I want boxing fans to watch carefully with these pundits and these experts. Listen to what they're saying. Listen to them. Those people are telling you now, Joshua's the next best thing since sliced bread, and he's ready, and he's in the world top five, and he's this and that. Listen carefully. And then listen to those other guys that are saying, whoa, whoa, hold on a second. This guy needs to be tested. We need to know what he's about. You need to know what he can do before we start giving him that world rating. This is not hating. This has been constructive. And a lot of boxing fans can't be constructive. It's either he's a great or he's a bum. There's no in between. And that was my feelings on that. And the way tonight on Box Nation, David Price was built up. You know, this is the, you know, if you don't win this fight tonight, it's the end of his career. Really? Says who? Says you? No. So that fight didn't work out right. Oh, if I remember rightly, there was another British heavyweight that had four attempts at the world title. And he's Britain's best, one of the best celebrities, Frank Bruno. Yeah, Bruno got beat by some top-class fighters. But now, hold on. Price just got beat by two guys who are very good. I think Tepper's pretty good. I don't think Tepper's a bum. And I don't think Thompson's a bum. So, I don't get it. I don't get it. I don't get this all. It's the end of his career. So I think it's highly irresponsible for the same people that are boosting the fighter and telling him he's the best thing since sliced bread. They're the same people now telling you, building a story and saying, you know, well, you know, if you don't win this fight tonight, it's the end for Pricey. Is it? Is it just bad matchmaking? People say, oh, well, Pricey, you know, he's a chinless wonder and he's not good enough. And he's not this and he's not that. Well, let's look at it another way. That's why you've got trainers. That's why you've got trainers. And that's why those guys on the couch are not trainers. And a trainer will look at Price and say, okay, look, let's go back in the tape and see. You got caught with that shot there. Well, you know what? You had your chin in the air. Let's technically work on that. That's what sparring is for. That's what training camps are for. That's what a trainer is there to do. So you sit down and tell me a guy's career is over because he got chinned by a guy that was pretty good. Come on. He didn't get knocked up by a guy who had a record of 15 fights and 15 defeats. He just got knocked up by an undefeated fighter that nobody knows how good he is. How good he is. Nobody knows how good he is. Oh, Tepper's a bum. Based on what? If Tepper goes out and chins Joshua tomorrow, what are you going to say then? Joshua's a bum? Get over yourselves, man. And just think a second. Yes, he got chinned. It was a bad defeat. But you congratulate Tepper and say, look, son, that was a really good win. You closed the range down and you executed the game plan. Price didn't execute any game plan. He had no game plan. He had no game plan. There was no, at no point in time did he understand what the danger zone was. He didn't understand, look, at this range, you don't engage. At this range, you don't engage. At this range, you do engage. He's going to come out fast at you. So he's going to come out fast. You're going to be pumping that jab out. Some sort of game plan. Didn't have that. Again, Price looked disorganized as soon as the guy was coming at him. You haven't coached that. You haven't been trained for that. You've been on the pads probably hitting one long left jab, right hand, and, you know, hitting the back pads and the trainer saying to you, oh, you sound great. You're hitting with real power there, mate. Hitting with real power there. Instead of really taking a step back and saying to yourself, you know what? You know, we need to have a game plan with this guy. We've seen this guy, Tepper, when he's up close, he can do damage. Let's see, throw 1-2 and spin off. So those are just my thoughts and everything else comes across my mind. I will engage with, but at this minute in time, I think I'll stop there. I've got almost 30 people in the room at the moment, so it's time to check out, see who's in the room. I think I've expressed how I feel at the moment. Sorry, boxing fans, but this is how I feel at the moment, and I just couldn't hold it in. So let's go to the room and find out who's saying what. Okay, let's go. Marky Bay says, good evening. Ingram, what a shot indeed. Ruben Caddick says, LOL. Ruben Caddick says, I laugh so much, but deep down I felt bad. Andre says, beautiful KO by Tepa. Indeed it was. Marky Bay says, nothing funny about it, mate. It's boxing, sad to watch if anything. Ruben says, I laughed hard. Marky B says, shows what kind of person you are. Tindy says, bad matchmaking from Sauerland. I have to agree with you there. Ruben Caddick says he was in shock. Ruben then says, I feel for Price. He must feel so sad at the moment. Marky Bay says, I blame Fanny Smith. He's bad luck in my opinion. Hope Ingram speaks on that. I have. Ruben Caddick says, Tyson Fury knew what Price was and predicted it a long time ago before it happened. Yes, he did. In the interview I did with him, I think it was the first interview I did with Tyson Fury ever, he mentioned it back in late 2012 or 2013. Tyson predicted it. So, yes. So did Adam Booth, Tindy says. Yeah, Booth knew something too. He couldn't get rid of him quick enough, says Marky B. Benjamin M says, better out this way than get killed by AJ. I don't subscribe to that. David Price is a pussy. I said that first class straight to the camera. David, that was Tyson Fury, says. Caddick says, Tepa hits hard and AJ, quite possibly. Let's go through here. Matthew Wall, well, Ingram. No Tommy Brooks and Price showed flaws in the inside game. Franny Smith is not good enough trained at this level. Price has a poor chin and needs all the help he can get. There we go, Matthew's exactly what I've said there. Sarah Lake, good evening. Good evening, Matthew. Good to see you in the room, Sarah. Wow, gutted for Price. Yeah, I'm gutted too. But I'm more disgusted at the way boxing fans have got to Twitter. Boxing pundits as well. Shocking. By the way, I was always skeptical on Price, okay? Sarah Lake says, David cannot keep a man away with his jab. Doesn't have to use his size at all. That's why he needs a trainer. He was knocked out clean this time. Worse than a toe-to-toe stoppage. Yes, agreed. But I think he would have knocked out most heavyweights in the world. Matthew Wall, he has no variation with his jab. To Sarah, he just has a ramrod straight jab. He's not even got a ramrod jab. He's got a flicker of a jab. It's a disgrace. Robin Cat says, Matt Ingram is mad. Yeah, I am. I'm not having him. Casual fans, I guess, yes. Price's jab has no effect on Tepa. Price hasn't got a jab. Price will get a better jab in the doctor's office. Flu jab, probably. Thomas was ranked 8th at the time, Ingram. Yeah, he was in the top 10. And I got ranked. He was ranked 8th. He just got beat by Klitschko, I believe. SKC says he's lost his confidence, not been the same since Thompson. I agree. Matthew Wall says by Boxrec. Listening to Baylor, watching Orange is the New Black, download The Walking Dead season 4. Zeta Creation, good to hear. 4C Sports Media, check out 4C Sports Media. I'm a guest on his show, Adam 4C Box. Check him out as the sports media. He's in the room. Shout out to Adam. 4C. He panics. Chaos says, dude, Price was never that good. Anytime he's gone up above a domestic level, he's not only loses, but gets embarrassed. He KO'd. I have to disagree with you, Chaos, because Price fought Thompson and Tepa. Thompson is a pretty good heavyweight, and Tepa, we don't know how good he is yet, but he looks decent. And if he hits any heavyweight, that's what he needs. Maybe help with a sports psychologist, more than a sports psychologist. Price will retire, Sarah. I don't think so. I hope he doesn't. Michael Benson says, good evening, Michael. David Price's career is a stark warning to all of us not to jump in the media and hype train. Hope Joshua can learn from Price's mistakes so he doesn't make them himself. I hope Price ices Joshua. I wouldn't mind Joshua versus Tepa. SK says, Ryan Caldwell. Matthew Wall says, that's it for him. Tepa was nothing special. That's a very, 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 very harsh thing to say, Matthew Wall. As far as I'm concerned with Tepa, he's unknown quantity. If that hit Wilder on the chin and knocked Wilder out, he'd probably be jumping up and down saying he's the best thing since sliced bread. Ryan Caldwell says he was all he was a boxer who just had one punch against bums. It was nothing else to his game. Well, he looks like, because he hasn't got a good trainer in his corner. Let's keep going. Fury beats Tepper comfortably. Okay. I don't want to have that conversation. I'm not going to have a conversation with Fury and Tepper. No, skipping all that tonight. No Fury Tepper talk. Hi, Baylor Activity Boxing Channel. Good evening, Andrew, Rich. This is not about Fury tonight. This is about Tepper and Price. There will be no Tyson Fury Tepper talk tonight. Sorry. All of a sudden, people think Tepper is Mike Tyson. Stop getting hyped up, guys. Sorry, you've got to give Tepper his credit, his due. He closed the range down, got inside against a bigger man, and he won. Boxing fundamentals. And for that reason, he deserves all the credit in the world. And if you're a man who knows boxing, this is about boxing. This is about, you know, training for a fight, executing a game plan. And if you've boxed before, you will understand that the execution of a game plan going right. Tonight, Tepper did that against a big puncher. Price is a big puncher. He's been known as a big puncher. So for Tepper to walk, get inside and land a shot, that takes confidence. It takes heart to even arrange to make the fight happen. And let's remember, all you Joshua fans, it was rumored, and a lot of boxing coaches know that Joshua got knocked out in sparring by Price. So, you know, your chin. And if you think that Joshua's got a great chin, that's fine. But remember, when he's been put under pressure, as like Wilder, when he was put under pressure, go back and look, he's been stopped and he's been dropped. So Joshua is no Superman. Let's keep going. Price needs to train with Peter Fury. That'd be interesting. Franny is bad luck to Price. I've always said it. I agree. Ryan Caldwell says, his jabs are awful, nothing in them. Guna says, could Tepper become world champion? That's a good question. Now, that's a conversation I'd like to enter. Well, Tepper versus Chagayev. I'd give Tepper a good chance against Chagayev. With that right hand, he's iced Rogan with that right hand. That right hand seems to have some pop on it. I'd like to see Chagayev Tepper. I'd watch that fight. I'd back Tepper on that. Guna says he hits like a horse. He does indeed. But Benson says horses kick. Matthew Wall says, yeah, but he's slow feet and no lateral movement. Excuse me. The same people backing Lucas Brown. You could say he's got slow feet and no lateral movement. I don't know. He knows how to execute a game plan. So you can tell you about slow feet and no lateral movement. Would you get in the ring with him? I'm going to skip this one. Tepper is like Christian Hammer with a big punch. How can you say that? You've seen how good Christian Hammer is because you got done by what? Whack. You can't level a man off like that until you've seen him get beat. So I'm not gonna enter that sort of conversation. Tepper won't last long with someone who can keep him at range. Well, I think that's a bit of a, if I were to break that statement down, that really is, but you have to have somebody skilled to be able to do that and to be able to take a shot. Because at some point, Tepper's going to hit you. I don't quite subscribe to that. He goes, yeah, the other two was 42-year-old Sammy Rogan. Okay, Matthew, I think it was impressive. Do you know why it's impressive? Because he got rid of him in the first round to knock out Rogan and Sprott. He put him, he said, you're not in my league. You're not in my class. You have to get knocked out. I think it's quite the opposite. He done what he had to do with him. Wilder versus Tepper would be a great fight. Tepper KO's Wilder. Let me tell you something. If it was Tepper in the ring with Wilder the night he fought Molina and Wilder get hit with the same shot, what would we be talking about today? Okay, I'm going to skip through a lot of this. Zeta Creation says that Ruben Kellick first says, I'm making the same claims AJ fans do. Yeah. Well, let's just see what happens with AJ. Let's see what all these AJ fans are. In fact, what I might do is do a video and write down all the AJ fans before he gets beat and what they say. And let's hear what they say after he gets beat. I think I'm going to start doing that. Marky Bay says, Joshua will meet his facts match soon enough. I want to see where the fans go where he loses. Yep. Tepper is a puncher. Gary Cornish, he's not got the greatest chin. And if you look at his fight ambitions, he doesn't look very ambitious. Marky Ben says, you serious? Joshua's not developing his career. Blasting that man who has been stopped by Vitaly Klitschko, Fury, Chisora, etc. shows no development. Well, Tyson Fury sparred with Johnson and the sparring session lasted all 30 seconds. You heard what Peter Fury said before the fight. You heard what he said after the fight. You heard what Hugh Fury said. You heard what Kevin Johnson said. You know, he basically came for the payday. You know, if you just watch. You know, even Tyson Fury said he. So, I don't know. Ruben Kelly says he believes that Fury is the best heavyweight in the planet. Okay. Price can't protect that glass chin. Well, Vlad did a good job of it. Yeah, Michael Benson, this makes a very interesting point. Before the fight, especially Box Nation pundits, Tepper needs a lucky punch. Well, there you go there. I'm not saying no more than that. I didn't say it. Price doesn't have any confidence anymore. This chaos finished him for good. We'd love to see Joshua Tepper or Joshua Wilder. Okay. We don't have to be loyal, Ingram. We're paying to watch these fights. Right. This guy just wants to be contrary. When Price was winning, he was slagging him off. Sarah Lake says, let's be honest, his career is over. No, let's not be honest. He needs a good trainer. And that's the difference between... See, I think if you've boxed before and you've been in a ring and you've been in a ring with a guy who... If you've changed trainers, you can tell the difference with a trainer that... I just think that it's easy from the outside, from the couch sitting down, to make all these statements. It's very easy. But if you get in the ring, you get hit on the chin, you get punched about a bit, you have a different perspective of life. So I cannot turn and say, his chin is non-existent. Well, I've seen many fighters whose chin has been exposed. Tepper's a big puncher. Tepper's not a light punching guy, he's a big puncher. So to say his chin is non-existent is a bit harsh and he can't stay out of range. But I've mentioned these points beforehand. You need to have a trainer to do that. That's what a boxing trainer is there for, a boxing coach, a boxing mentor. That's why you've got to give credit to Manny Stewart and people around Manny Stewart to make Vladimir Klitschko how he was or how he is. That's why guys can't just walk in there and just hit him on the chin and falls over. There is an element of coaching and fundamentals there. So let's go to boxing fundamentals. I don't want to hear no more talk about he's got no chin, because that's easy to say. He's got no chin, he should retire. Those people who are saying that, we may as well switch off now, because the next conversation we're going to have is bringing David Price back. What would you do if you were going to bring David Price back now? And who would you bring in as his trainer? And what would you work on? Let's talk boxing fundamentals and let's get out the fanatic stuff. So I'm going to skip all this stuff about Price and Tepper being a barman. Let's talk constructive talk. Let's talk intelligent talk. Let's talk about boxing knowledge here. Okay. Carlton Palmer's in the room, everybody, just to let you know. Okay, 4C Sports Media says, a lot of people have been putting immense pressure on Price ever since he went pro, TV and promoters included. Maybe the US could be good for Price. I think so. It could be interesting, but he needs to have a decent, a world-class team around him. Nice to know you in the room, Colton. How about trying Chris Birdie? Offer to help Price soon after Thompson fight. Chris Bird's a very level-headed guy. He knows his boxing. I don't know what he's like as a coach. And can Price afford to take chances anymore? Good question. UK Boxing News says, to fully change your style at this level, you'd think that it would be too much at his age. Well, to change his style, this is interesting. Are you changing his style or are you just adding something to his style? Distance and timing? I don't know. It's a question of what can a world-class trainer do with David Price? You know, if anything, he's been knocked out twice, or three times, but against top quality opposition. He's not been knocked out by levels. He's been knocked out by top quality operators. He's not been knocked out a guy who's had 15 and 15 defeats. So to UK Boxing, Boxers News, I think it's a good question you're asking. But I, as a coach myself, I would look at David Price and say, okay, son, look, you've had some bad defeats here, but is that due to the fact of the way you've been managed, or is it because of the way you've been trained? And you'd ask yourself a question, okay, let's go back and look at these tapes. So he made a mistake and got chinned. That's at that level. If you get to that level and you make mistakes in boxing, one punch can change things. So yeah, he made a mistake. He got knocked out for it. Fine. But to say it's the end of his career, I think it's a bit harsh. But can he change his style? Would it be about changing his style or making him more aware? You know, the left jab. So changing his style would be to, instead of flicking a jab, ramming a jab home. Or fundamentals with Price making the decision before he gets to the ring whether he's going to engage up close. And if he's going to engage up close, practice engaging up close in sparring. If not, then when he gets up close, he does the Vladimir Klitschko thing and holds. So Price didn't know whether he wanted to hold when he was up close or he wanted to engage when he was up close. For the early rounds, maybe Price should have held and broken the rhythm of Tepper. This is something that, if you look at Klitschko fights, he likes to hold and tie up. So, who knows? But only a world-class trainer can answer that question, I think. I don't think it's down to boxing fans and those people who've never boxed before to have an opinion. They can have an opinion, but that shouldn't be stated as fact, merely an opinion. Okay, Matthew Wall says, Price needs to go back to basics, learn how to roll punches, tie up and take the fight to the out from the outside. We have advantages. Right, that's something constructive there, Matthew. We can work with that. That's something we can work with. Now we're talking boxing now. Guna says, how many times did Bruno lose before he beat McCall? There you go. That's a good point. Michael Ben says, I wouldn't bring him back. That's okay. But if I was, let's focus on what the positive. If you were to bring him back, I'll take him to America so he can rebuild in a completely different scene. I agree. That I would take him to America. I think it's time. And I would build Price he'd have to show me you before he even stepped into any other fights, a ramrod jab, that a flicking jab was over. For example, if I were talking to David Price as a trainer, I'd say to him, what is your philosophy behind throwing a left jab? Do you believe in the left jab? Do you believe in what the left jab can bring you? Do you realize that a left jab can make openings for you? Do you understand that left jab can bring distance and timing for you? Do you understand that a left jab is a nice place to place after your left jab to put your right hand in? Do you understand that your left jab can be used to maneuver your opponent around the ring? Do you use your left jab to actually blind an opponent before you can throw your right hand? Do you know you can use your left jab to back up an opponent, use it attackingly? You can use your jab as a range finder. There are different reasons why you can use the jab. But David, what is your philosophy of the left jab? What, like, I was always taught that if you're going to throw a jab, have meaning about it. If you're going to throw a punch, have meaning or don't bother. And for Price, that flicking jab wasn't going to knock anybody out. It wasn't going to deter anybody. It wasn't going to stop Tepper coming forward. So technically, we're talking here, the jab needs to be ramrod or forget it. You know, and he needs to be able to have a left jab. That's the first thing, fundamental. Not just pouring jab, a ramrod jab, and know what you're doing with the left jab. Clearly, his trainer and Price himself has no idea what a left jab, what the point of a left jab is. Okay, Henry Parker says Price has got potential, I think, or maybe Tepper's got potential. I'm not sure which one you're talking about. Michael Benson also said, if I were to bring him back to the first member of the staff would be recruiting as a sports psychologist. Yes, true. But I think the first person I have in his team is a coach who was a mentor. Somebody who's going to stay by him, by his side, and not Franny Smith, somebody of a different philosophy. I believe that when you hang around somebody long enough, you take on their philosophies. And I don't know what Franny Smith's philosophy is, but his philosophy is flawed at world level. That's clear to see. Okay, I'm going to skip some of these comments because I'm not entertaining them. Ifti Ahmed says, good evening, Ifti. Ingles are good at installing confidence, so that could be an option, but it all depends on Price's frame of mind. Yeah, that's true. Brendan Ingle is one of the best, if not the best trainer we've still got in this country in terms of coaching fighters and bringing on world titles. UK Boxing News says, I hear you, but let me ask you, Vlad, Fury, Hay, Wilder, do you see him winning any of these fights? If he fights like he fought tonight, no. Here we go. 4C Sports Media says, he needs a great defensive coach. There are a lot of options out there. Will he possibly be sparring Vlad or Tyson soonish? Peter Fury or Jonathan Banks may see something they can work with. Yes, that's a key point, because I would still use David Price today to help sparring with for Klitschko. I think Team Fury would be a nice place for Price to land himself at, and I think that knockout might not be a bad thing for him, because he might get in there with Team Fury now. I don't know how that works out, but I certainly think David should work with Peter Fury. And I think philosophy is important for David Price now. Okay, UK Boxing says, and does he have the style enough to beat those fighters? Nobody likes to watch him get knocked out like today. That's why people want him to try. Yeah. Nobody wants to see him get knocked out, but nobody, I don't hear anybody saying anything about his trainer. I don't hear anybody saying anything about his trainer apart from guys here tonight. So, yeah. Henry Parker says, Price understands boxing. He needs to do that with his jab. He's very knowledgeable, but he's just lacking the confidence to commit with the jab tonight. Thank you, Henry Parker. Talking lots of sense here. Okay, Matthew Wall says, it's more than that, Henry. Price doesn't even throw the right hand correctly. His arm doesn't fully extend. There's so much work needed to make Price a full article. Who is willing to do that? A damn good trainer who believes in him. A damn good trainer that believes in him, and not a fanatic that doesn't. Fanatics don't believe in anybody. only when the gravy train, or glory hunters, only when the gravy train's going well. That's not a loyal fan. There's no loyalty in that. That's just having an opinion. But I, you know, to be a fan of somebody or to support a fighter, you know, I don't think it's over. You know, Ruben Caddick says, I can't see Price and Fury getting along in a camp at all. I think Fury might just be what Price needs. A kick up the backside, some true words spoken to him in his ear, and it would make the sparring sessions interesting. And Fury's going to need all of Price's punch power, because he's going to go up against a guy who will hit him back. It's levels. Price has got the trait to fall back on. Bazza Pope, great. Tepper looks like the dad out of Stavros's Flatley, great. Okay, but I think for me that it's not the end of the world for David Price, although Box Nation would like to tell you that. Boxing fans or boxing fanatics would like to tell you that David Price, his career is over, he's a bum, he's got no future. I'm sure they said the same thing about Frank Bruno when he got beat by Bunkrish Smith, Tim Witherspoon, Mike Tyson, Lennox Lewis. I'm sure the same people said about Lennox Lewis when he got knocked out by Oliver McCall. You know, same people said the same thing about Shannon Briggs when he got knocked out by Darrell Wilson. Same things people said about George Foreman, and probably got knocked out by Jimmy Young. You know, then when Holyfield got beat by Riddick Bowe, he was too small. Fans said, retire. Same fans said about Evander Holyfield when he fought Mike Tyson. Holyfield's too small. He'd have a heart attack. He's not fit. He should retire. He should be in a wheelchair. He shouldn't be this. He shouldn't be that. And he turned around and he ended up beating Mike Tyson. The same people said Danny Williams was shot, was finished. He shouldn't be in the ring with Mike Tyson. Mike Tyson's going to destroy him. Same fans, same experts. Danny Williams ends up that night beating Mike Tyson. Any way you look at it, there's always somebody in a corner telling you you can't do it. My message to you, David Price, as I've said it before, and I've said it again, it's not about those people telling you you can't do it. It's about those people that tell you that you can do it. I believe you still can do it. I still believe you can be a major force in the heavyweight division. You've got bags of experience. You've got bags of talent. Yes, you lack confidence. Yes, your chin has been exposed, but it's been exposed to guys at top level. And you've been found wanting in those fights. But I would have a closer look at the team around you and say to yourself, well, if you're going to be world heavyweight champion, at least align yourself with somebody who has produced world champions, world heavyweight champions, somebody who knows about world heavyweight boxing, and somebody who can mentor you physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. I would stay away from boxing forums about people telling you that you're finished. Those are not the sort of people you want in your life. Sort of people you want in your life now, people can embrace you, give you a bit of love, have some time out, have a think. You're a young man, you're not an old man. You didn't get beat by a guy who had a 15-15 record with 15 fights and 15 defeats. Nobody knows how good Tepper is. And if Tepper goes out now and wins a world title, then what? You know, I don't hear anybody calling out Tony Thompson anytime soon because people still respect Thompson, but they won't give him the credit. You know, it just shows you why Vladimir Klitschko should be given all the credit in the world because of how far he's come after getting blasted out by Corey Sanders, knocked out or knocked down by Lamont Brewster, getting dropped by Samuel Peter, and still being a reigning world champion to have done those things. I think that it's important that we take a step back and we say, okay, that was a bad defeat tonight in Germany. It was a bad defeat. against how good? The next world champion, a potential next world champion? We don't know. So he's still unknown, Tepper. What we do know is that there were mistakes made in the ring tonight. Fundamental mistakes that were made. And anybody can sit here and say, oh, you shouldn't do this and you shouldn't do that and you shouldn't do this and you shouldn't do that. All I'm saying is that don't give up on yourself, mate. I still think you've got a career in boxing. I don't believe that two defeats on a record or three defeats on a record mean you're not going to become a world champion. And that was a tough fight tonight. Again, against a guy that we don't know how good he is yet because he hasn't been beaten or he hasn't been found out yet. But a credit for you to step in the ring with an unbeaten fighter with his big punch. Now what needs to happen for you where the boxing fans have got no expectations of you, just have expectations of yourself and make the cutthroat decisions necessary to become world heavyweight champion, because I believe you still can be world heavyweight champion. But I really do think it's time you made those decisions. Why you left Adam Booth or why you left Tommy Brooks, I don't know. Why you went back to Franny Smith, it's obviously something you saw in Franny Smith, I don't know. Maybe you felt it's something you trusted in him. But if you can sit down and justify the left jab, the inability to decide whether you're going to fight up close or you're going to hold when he's up close, the lack of a game plan, yeah, pulling straight back out from punches, all these things, you know where you've gone wrong. Well, maybe you don't, but you definitely need some help. And rather than call out, get former world champions, world heavyweight champions to help you out, who have no proven record of producing world champions, why don't you go to a trainer who's got proven worth working with a world champion and invest in them and have a trainer that's going to invest in you in not just your boxing career, but in you as a person. Give it one more last go, David, but get the team right. That's my final thoughts to you, David Price. I'm still a fan. I'm still supporting you. I see you still have ability. Those are my thoughts. You'll notice that there are some people in this room that I'm not even acknowledging because they've got a habit of coming in the room and just talking absolute troll. So I don't, my way now is just not to acknowledge them. So they just talk, just ignore them. Abdullah says, Price is not done if he doesn't want to be done. Agreed, Abdullah, well said. The rich kid says Tepper will never be champ. Well, you know what? I'm kind of glad some of the people they've got in this room, I'm kind of glad I have no sort of friendship with, and I wouldn't want them around me. That's for sure. Because if I didn't do well at something, or I failed at something in the first attempt or the second attempt, and I didn't meet their expectations, I certainly wouldn't want to be around them. There's a lot of negativity tonight in the room. And I don't do that stuff. I'm realist and say, you know what? Sure, Price tonight came on stuck against a guy who's pretty decent and unbeaten. And there are a lot of boxing experts in the room tonight. It's a wonder why they're not managing and promoting fighters and training fighters. My final thoughts on this and addressing this is, you know, it's a great reflection of society today that when somebody fails, we are quite happy to dig their grave and throw the dirt over the top. And then when they're at the top of the mountain, we're quite happy to jump for joy with them as we feel like we're part of that journey as well. But you know, for me, the greatest joy is seeing somebody come back from adversity and win, because That's a spirit that's needed in life. Because in life, there are times that things don't work out the way you want them to work out. Things don't go the way that we want them to go. And a setback is only excuse for a greater comeback. That's my mindset. That's my mindset. As Bruno did, he tried again. He became world heavyweight champion, despite all those people. Yeah, he lost his title in the first defense to Mike Tyson, but nobody can say he didn't become world champion. And I still back David Price. Regardless if he does continue boxing or he doesn't, I back him as a man. Because he's in a sport that's a very hard sport to be in. And a lot of people who are talking have never got in the ring, have never taken a punch, have never done the training, they've never had to slog and be in a ring when they didn't want to be, never had to do it. So it's easy for them to make throwaway comments. But to those people who have boxed and have been in the ring and understand what it takes, probably will be a lot more sympathetic. UK Boxing News, Boxers News says, good personal message to Pricey. Hope he watches and listens. Yeah, I hope he does. He made the adjustment before. I remember talking, saying a video, saying to Pricey, look, Pricey, get yourself away from Liverpool, get yourself a sports psychologist and get yourself a trainer on board. He seemed to listen to most of that, but he went back to Franny Smith, which is not good news. If the Armour says, Cleverley was absolutely distraught after his loss and similarly went on holiday and to regroup, Price needs to take a break and reassess. Guna says, Price needs a fresh start, but Sowland needs sacking. Yeah, I think so. Rich Kid says he's been knocked out a few times. The amateurs too. So was Anthony Joshua. So was Wilder. In fact, David too got knocked out in the amateurs as well. Marky Bay says if he does decide to box again, he needs to leave Franny and join with a proper trainer over here, not in Germany. Well, maybe I'd like to see him go to the States and fight a lot of undercards. And build himself from there if he really wants to be world champion, working with a trainer to mentor him. I don't quite know what to say to you guys now because I also don't subscribe to the fact that people just sit on chairs that don't box and can just make throwaway statements like, oh, he should retire now. His career is over. Are the sort of people that we don't need in the sport of boxing. It's not like he's 40 years old or 45 years old. He got knocked out. He got clipped with a shot. It's a mistake he made. You could say it was an amateurish mistake he made. And at a pro level, it's unforgivable. I wouldn't be surprised if Al Heyman still signed him. There we go. So I don't know. Oh no, Tommy Brooks, he didn't get beat when he was with Tommy Brooks, did he? Bruce Wayne. Good evening, Bruce, how are you doing? He was with Tommy Brooks for a couple of fights and pulled away. He needs to work on his outside boxing and use his length as an advantage like Vladimir. Indeed. Indeed. Let's talk about boxing trainers. If you were David, let's play fantasy David Price trainer, fantasy David Price management team. First of all, who would you have as David Price's manager? If you had somebody to manage David Price, who would you have managing him? Who would you have as David Price's promoter? And who would you have as trainer? Would you have an all-out trainer? Would you have a strength and conditioning team? Who would back David Price today? A 4C Sports Media says Al Heyman needs other heavyweights. Could happen. Yeah, it could happen. It's tough. To me, let's see who I'd have. Barry Jones of Rawling did say, where does Price go from here? So he must think something. Yeah. Where does he go from here? I don't know. If Tepper ends up being a world champion, or Tepper becomes, you know, a belt holder, then where does he go from here? He got beat by a top fighter. He continues his career. Freddie the joke coach Roach. No, I wouldn't have Freddie Roach. Freddie Roach, having said that, Freddie, if you wanted an attacking coach, I guess you could pick Freddie Roach. But training heavyweight boxers is different to training any other fighters. You need a coach, I think, that has trained heavyweight fighters. So you need a heavyweight coach there. Eddie Hearn hasn't made a mistake with AJ yet. No comments on that. Michael Benson continues saying, because he's only 13-0. Fix Allen's are doing a good job, like you say. It's the training that needs a fix. It does. Virgil Hunter. Virgil Hunter, think about Virgil Hunter for a second. He's the perfect guy. Fighters who get knocked out or beat up or destroyed, he seems to like be the care home for those fighters. Andre Berto, I think Margarito, and a few others who've been either exposed at world levels or beaten up or knocked out brutally, end up going to Virgil Hunter. It's like a care home for exposed fighters. Amir Khan. But this is heavyweight boxing. I think you need a trainer that's got some experience at world level as a heavyweight trainer. I was thinking Hunter has a couple of young heavyweights instead. Yeah, but it's what he does with those heavyweights. John David Jackson. Now, I think he's a top-class trainer. I think John David Jackson's a top-class trainer. He is a student of the game. I rate him very highly as a trainer. Nazim Richardson. I'd like to see Brother Naz. Have a look at Price as well. So Nazim Richardson, James Ali Bashir, don't know about Buddy McGirt, John David Jackson, not Virgil Hunter. I like Virgil, and he's got that sort of, he's got the probably capabilities to be a great mentor, but I'm not sure if he'd have time for David Price. He needs good basic boxing skills, jab and defense. So any good British boxing trainer, Rob McCracken. McCracken's a good person to talk to. Definitely. Peter Fury, yeah, there might be a conflict of interest there, but yeah, Peter Fury would be good because, you know, Price would eat, sleep, train at Team Fury. So Price and Fury, I think Peter could do a great job with him. But I don't know if England. See, if Price were prepared to get himself over to France and go quietly over to France and train with Peter Fury, then fine. You know, but I don't know. I'd like to see Price in America, to be honest. Price can't go to a Fury camp. Are you part of Team Fury? As far as I'm concerned, when I talked to Peter Fury, he was seriously considering David Price to prepare for Klitschko. So what you're talking about is news to me, unless you're on the inside of the Fury camp. I think there's a strong possibility that Fury that Price would go to the Fury camp. Business is business. They're my personalities. Business is business. You never would have thought Steve Cunning would end up being sparring partners for Tyson and Fury after the way those two finished the fight. Cunningham had really bad feelings towards Fury because he felt that he was fouled against Tyson Fury. But yet they ended up being in the camp together sparring. So I don't know where you're going with that philosophy. I think even more now than ever, Fury and Price would get together. More now than ever. Nazim Richardson is definitely one I would look seriously to. Bruce Wayne says, I heard John David Jackson is training Brian Jennings. What do you think of that, Ingram? Well, if you go back and listen to my interview with Brian Jennings before the Klitschko fight, he alluded to the fact that his old trainer, Fred Jenkins, as much as he cared for Fred Jenkins and Fred had done a lot for him, there was some strain in that relationship. And he also alluded, he didn't say come out right, he said that maybe Fred wasn't prepared to get the extra help necessary and to make the fundamental changes necessary to take Bryant to the next level. So I guess maybe it's good that he's going to get the change. I think John David Jackson's a fantastic student of the game. I think he's a fantastic coach. I think he's a world-class coach. I think that, I would like to see Jennings putting his punches together more. I would like to see Jennings... I'd like to see more from Brian Jennings. I think he's one of the best heavyweights in the world. And I think that with John David Jackson. You know, I think that'd be great. Because what do you think of Enzo Calzacchi having a go? No. Enzo Calzacchi has done nothing as a heavyweight coach. And you're experimenting now. In Price's career now, he needs a surety. He needs a surety. Lennox Lewis didn't bring him a surety. Lennox Lewis caused more damage than he did bring any sort of clarity. Lennox Lewis was a great champion. But Lennox Lewis had done nothing as a trainer. I would never have said David Price with Lennox Lewis. Not now, nor ever. Because Lennox had done, you proved nothing as a trainer. And then you bring Lennox Lewis in at a key moment. Yes, he's a good sort of like figurehead or mascot or a, I don't know, something to make you look good. But in terms of a trainer, it's an insult to the top trainers in the world who graft every day at their craft and work hard. Lennox, in terms of advice being world heavyweight champion or what it took to become world heavyweight champion, his advice would have been good, yes, in kind of maybe managing them and saying who Price should fight. But as a trainer, that's a no-go. That's a bad, whoever suggested Lennox Lewis as a trainer was awful. It was a shy. I think I made a statement on that because Lennox has trained nobody. And Lennox, and another point to it, who did Lennox Lewis ever fight as a professional who was a southpaw? Name me one. Price won't go to Fury's camp. A lot of old bad blood there. Price won't want to be sparring partner for someone who has had designs of knocking out a few years ago and who is now light years ahead. Interesting, Chris Jones, but I would disagree with you there. I would disagree with you there because when I spoke to Peter Fury on and off camera or off air, I got every indication that they would use David Price as a sparring partner. This is business. And personal vendettas needs to be put to one side. It's business. Tyson needs to become, wants to become a heavyweight champion of the world. And if he's going to let a vendetta or bad feeling, bad blood between him and Price, you know, give him the best possibility to become world heavyweight champion, I think it's silly. I don't think that, you know, I'm not saying that they have to be best buddies. I'm not saying they have to be drinking partners. But, you know, things were said, and things were said on my channel between Price and Fury. And I don't know. I think that Peter Fury is a great mediator. And I think that Price will end up in Camp Fury, personally. And even more so now, because I think it would be a good experience for him. Tyson Fury and Price have legit beef and will be embarrassing for Price to train with him. Why would it be embarrassing? Why would it be embarrassing? I don't get it. I don't understand why it would be embarrassing. I don't agree with that at all. But I think I don't even know why I decided to even respond to that comment. The whole Lewis thing was a gimmick and a sideshow. It's embarrassing in hindsight. It was embarrassing from the start, the beginning, and the end. It was embarrassing. Even he was coming out to the theme tune of the big payback. That's Lennox Lewis's stuff. That's what I'm saying. Lennox Lewis is trying to make David Price him. So I'm not saying Fury's won't. I'm saying Price wouldn't. His Price wouldn't let him. Pride. Yeah, pride may be an issue there with David Price, but don't know. I don't know. I don't think pride comes in. I don't know if pride can come into it now after getting knocked out by Tepper. Like I said, I think the olive branch may come from Peter Fury for David Price. I would not be surprised if Peter Fury got in touch with David Price. I really wouldn't, because just the character of the man, and wish him, you know, commiserations, and you know, say to him that if he ever needs some help, he would help him out. I just don't see Peter Fury being that man, you know. But there you go. Depends on Price wanting to travel and relocate. His excuse not training with Booth was the traveling back and forth. At least Anna Khan got his head together and made changes to improve and succeed. Agreed. I've got to say that about Anna Khan. He did do that. And if you remember, if you go back and listen, I would challenge people to go back and listen to the tape when Khan got knocked out by Prescott. And I believe Carl Froch said Khan should retire. Carl Froch now is a pundit, and a full-time pundit for Sky Sports. So make what you want of that. Khan has since become unified champion, and I think was ranked number one at one point by the Ring magazine as a unified champion until he fought Danny Garcia. Yeah, I know. That's what Froch said. And a lot of good other pundits said that Khan should retire. So that's why I'm not this big, you should retire. No. Lewis training Price was like Apollo. Lewis training, Lewis training Price was like Apollo training Rocky, except not as successful. I'd love to see Peter train Price. I would. I'd love to see it as well. Henry Parker says, Joshua got so many gift decisions in the amateurs. Got to take that into consideration. Okay, I don't know that, but if Henry's saying that, then it's interesting. A lot of people believe that Joshua should be a gold medalist. Froch always has and always will show animosity towards Khan. LOL. Yeah, he has shown animosity towards Khan. Yeah, I guess so. So Al Heyman, I don't think he's a promoter or manager, to be honest. So I would have either John David Jackson. I don't know how it would work with Peter Fury. I think Peter Fury is what they call, I'd call him a mentor and a trainer. So Peter Fury would be good for this side of the world or the UK. I'd like to see him, John David Jackson. I really would. I have hope in David Price. And I would love to still interview David Price. I really would. I'd love, even more so now, I'd love to interview him. I'd love to see him because I'd love to talk to him and hear his views on what it was like being boosted up by the British public. Now he's been knocked out, how he feels about his career. I'd love to talk to David. I would love to talk to you about boxing. I would love to be able to sit down and pick your brain and how you feel about your career, because it's those sort of interviews that mean a lot. You know, it's okay. Yeah, John David Jackson. So I don't know if there's any US fans in the room or US listeners, but who would you recommend as a trainer? Well, John David Jackson is one of them I would definitely recommend. Let me see who else we've got. Nazim Richardson, I mentioned him. Abel Sanchez, don't know what he's done. I don't know if he's got anyone in his camp he can have as a heavyweight, Abel Sanchez. Let me think who else. Nazim Richardson, Abel Sanchez, John David Jackson. You've got Buddy McGurk. You've got Fred Jenkins. You've got Ariola's trainer. That's Henry Ramirez. I don't know about him. He never looks like he's improving. I would get someone like David Price to go and have a long chat with someone like George Foreman. I really would. I think because he's a man that's been beat. He's come back. George Foreman, and he's an old wise head. I'd like to even go and have a word with Chris Bird, you know. And he talks sense as well. Ingram, who do I think tomorrow will win between Quigg and Martinez? Let's kind of change the mood in here. Scott Quigg fights tomorrow night against Martinez. My thoughts on Scott Quigg, he's a good combination puncher. Good body puncher. But I think this is the best fighter Quigg has fought in his whole career. And I think there are a lot of things. I'm always fascinated by Joe Gallagher. I'm fascinated, but I guess I'm not a Joe Gallagher hater, but I've really looking at this guy with a microscope, and I'm really looking at him, magnifying glass with him tomorrow night, because I want to know what Joe Gallagher is, what he's like tactically as a coach when his fighters are not in fights that are gimme fights. In other words, if you look at Joe Gallagher's record, a lot of his fighters that have won have been in fights that I believe that they would won. I've always called it the 90-10 club, means that their fighter or his fighters have always been in the 90% position and the other fighter has been in the 10% position of winning a fight. So that makes Gallagher look good. But I'd love to see how Gallagher responds or he trains a fighter when they're up against it. Now you've got Martinez, who we know can punch. We know he's going to have no issues in terms of traveling or time zones. I don't know if he's got any weight issues, but I want to know tomorrow night, and I hope they put the camera in Joe Gallagher's corner. I hope they turn the volume up in Joe Gallagher's corner, because I don't know. I've never heard Joe Gallagher. Every time Joe Gallagher's in a fight where his fighter is not in a winning position, the camera even seems to go quiet on Joe Gallagher, or they seem to focus on the other corner. So tomorrow night, I want to see if they play the same games. I want to hear what Joe Gallagher says as a trainer. When his fight's getting beaten up and sent back to the corner, I want to hear what he's saying. Because I heard in his corner, when Smith was doing well against Abraham in the first fight of the body shots, that's when Smith was doing well, and he hurt Abraham to the body. And then all of a sudden went back to fighting, throwing punches to the head. Now, if I were a trainer and I just saw my fighter just hurt my fight, the other fighter to the body, I'd say, hey, you hit him with the body shots. He doesn't like the body shots. Get back on him. But after that, Smith went out there and fought throwing proper head punches. So I didn't understand that. So I want to know what Gallagher says tomorrow night. Scott Quigg doesn't move his head like most Gallagher fighters. They don't move their head. And at world level, you've got to move your head. And when you're in the exchange, we saw was a fight that I saw Scott Quigg get knocked down. Anybody can get knocked down in boxing. But it's strange. But sadly for, well, not sadly, worryingly for Scott Quigg is when he got tagged, pulling straight back from a punch in the pocket, throwing a punch and getting dropped, caught himself. I don't want to see, I don't want to see Quigg exchanging with Martinez. I really don't. Because if he exchanges with Martinez, I think he comes a second best. I think Quigg's got to go to breaking Martinez down to the body and look to try and stop Martinez in the second half of the fight. I think it's a dangerous fight. I'm just going to answer one comment from Mr. Carlton Palmer tonight. And I'm only going to answer this one. He says, has Ingram got something against UK fighters, UK trainers, LOL? No, I've given you my assessment as to what I think of Joe Gallagher. I've given you my reasons why. And I've given you, tomorrow night, I'm going to be watching Joe Gallagher a lot more intently. There's nothing I've got against Gallagher. And I said it at the start of my conversation here. You've got to start listening a little bit more, Carlton. You're going to get me mad. So I'm going to not engage with you tonight. But Joe Gallagher has got a lot of pundits or a lot of credit for winning British titles. That's fine. He made a statement the other day that if he had Paul Smith at the beginning of his career, Paul Smith would have been a world champion. And there was somebody on Twitter turned around and said, yeah, like you've got a stable of world champions. You know, I don't know how good Joe Gallagher is. Is he one of these trainers that is very good to come for a British title? You know, like, for example, if you look at someone like Brendan Ingle, you can look at his caliber because you see what Ingle has done. He's produced area champions, English champions, British champions, Commonwealth champions, European champions, and world champions at different weight divisions. Brendan Ingle's done that, and they've got a new world champion, Mikael Brook. So something must work. They've got a stable of fighters from British area English to world championships. That is what I call a world-class coach, because you've done it through all the levels. Pron Star Kaluminati says, you know how they work. When it's a bad time, they will go to the other corner and listen in on them. Sky also protect their fighters with commentators too. They do. So I'm glad you're in the room, Kaluminati. Name some good UK trainers. You don't have to give them credit. I just did, you burk. If you look at, that's one UK trainer that I give a lot of credit to. You also have to look at Adam Booth. Adam Booth has done what he's done with certain fighters. If you look at Booth, where his success has been fighters who can punch and punch at fighters who can move. If you look at the success he's had with David Haye and the success he had with Cecil was having with George Groves, because two guys who can punch and can move. So yeah, thank you, Carlton, for joining us tonight. So is there anybody else in the room who wants to talk about trainers in the UK? So in terms of what we're talking about, back to the point about Martinez and Quigg, I don't want to see him exchanging with Martinez early. Martinez is going to come at like a steam train, and he's going to try and engage with Quigg and try and take Quigg out and hit him on the chin. How good he is, I don't know. I don't know how good Quigg is. I'd like him to be really good. Watch Hearn's face when his fighters lose tomorrow. The other thing, Anthony Crawler. Let's talk about Anthony Crawler for a second. It's great the guy's got a world title shot. But was it that bad? And was Hearn that desperate that he didn't give Crawler a meaningful warm-up fight before he fought for a world title? It just seems to me that he just got, said, you know what? It's a world title shot for you, mate. It is a world title shot for you. You know, I promised you a world title shot back then. I'm honoring my contract. Here's a world title shot for you. I'm honoring my contract. If you win, you lose, great. No matter, make a difference to me. If you win a world title, it's great matchmaking by me. If you lose a world title, well, fine. But at the end of the day, I was pushed because I had to push other fighters' careers on. That's what it kind of seemed to me. You know. So I can't remember what I was saying, but I just read this here. It says I would like to see Crawler have a couple of warm-up fights before he fought for a world title. Personally, I think it's absolutely ridiculous that Crawler is fighting for a world title. If he comes back and he wins a world title with the injuries he's had, that's amazing. But Anthony Crawler, I'm sorry, he's a good fighter, but he's not world class. I'm sorry, he's a good fighter, but he's not world class. Sorry. He's been beaten by guys less than world class in his career before. He was on a nice little run, Crawler, actually. But is he world class? I don't think so. Is he fringe world class? Maybe. But he's had the injury, so nobody knows what Crawler looks like. I haven't heard. I don't know what him Crawler's like. Michael Benson, I'll give Box Nation pundits credit to Box Nation pundits tonight. Not afraid to mention AJ and even praise him. Sky pundits wouldn't even mutter on Box Nation's name fighter under their breath. Well, I guess so. Quigg Frampton. All depends on what Al Haymon has to say and what Al Haymon thinks and, you know, what he wants to do with Carl Frampton. You know, I think Carl Frampton is a very, very, very good fighter. But I've always thought he's a very good fighter. One of my favourites. Yeah, I don't know if Colin can pull it off. If he pulls it off, great, fantastic. Another British belt holder. There's a difference between a champion and belt holder. I think belt holders are guys that hold on to a belt until somebody decent comes along and takes the belt off them. Keep the belt warm. The champion is the guy that can stick around for a while, make numerous defenses, and has the versatility to fight various opponents at elite level and defeat them. Yeah, so I think Crawler will, and if he wins, he's a belt holder, not a champion. That's because I don't think he's that adaptable, but that's just my thoughts. Prawn Star Kilimanjaro says, mentality plays a big part in all you've talked about tonight. Absolutely. That's why Booth is one of the best. He seems to have the right mental approach and has the eye for something that will be working in a fight. Yes and no. Here's the yes. Works mentally very good with George Groves. I remember that he was able to calm George Groves down in a corner and get him to compose himself in a firefight with Kenny Anderson. Remember him? But no, because if you look at when Brian Jennings fought, what's the guy? I can see now, Mike Perez. He didn't know how to get inside of Perez's mind. If he could have got inside of Perez's mind, Perez would have been more dedicated in training. And the other thing is, Perez probably would have won the fight against Jennings because a lot of people said it was a close fight. And, you know, he probably could have taken a fight to Jennings, but who knows? And what I do know is that Booth, there are certain fighters who are receptive to Booth and are willing to make the changes. And I've got the physical capabilities, speed, movement, timing, power That's where you and plenty of heart. You look at Booth, those are the fights. Look at, that's why he's done well with Andy Lee, because Andy Lee has got a big punch. You look at David Haye, David Haye's got a big punch. You look at George Gobb, big punch. And you see where, kind of like where Booth's successes have been. Can't wait to see Andy Lee versus Billy Joe Saunders. I fancy Lee. What do you think? Look, I like Andy Lee. A lot of people know this channel, but I have always been a fan of Billy Joe Saunders. But it's about levels. If you look at Andy Lee's record, he has mixed and world class for a long time. Billy Joe Saunders, this is his first fight at world level. There's a huge difference. If you look at Andy Lee's record, he has knocked out or stopped guys at world elite level. Billy Joe Saunders hasn't. If you look at Andy Lee down the stretch, he can knock you out early, he can knock you down late. If you look at Billy Joe Saunders, he has, in the middle of fights, tired. He says that he's going to be in the best possible shape of his career against Andy Lee. I don't think you can change patterns, not like Billy Joe Saunders. He's had a pattern of tiring in fights, whether it's the Eubank fight, which he said he was going to be in the best shape of his career. He tired against Eubank. He tired against Ryder. He tired against Spike O'Sullivan. Nick Blackwell, I remember that fight where he tired badly against Blackwell. So for me, I don't care about, if you're going to be brutally honest, which I am going to be, I can see Andy Lee coming from behind and knocking Billy Joe Saunders out. I really can. I can see Andy Lee knocking Billy Joe Saunders out. Does Saunders punch hard enough to keep Lee on the canvas? He doesn't punch as hard as John Jackson. He doesn't punch as hard as Quillen. I don't think he punches as hard as Khabarov. So if he's going to box Lee, he's going to have to do it with 12 rounds without stopping. He's going to have to keep Lee turning and not allow Lee to land. Because if Lee lands on Saunders, I know Saunders has got a good chin at the level he's been at, but now he's fighting against the elite, which is Andy Lee. And Andy Lee, I think, is a premier middleweight. I think it's a premier middleweight. Not the best middleweight in the world, but a premier tested middleweight. Whereas Gennady Golovkin still is, he's the number one middleweight in the world, but hasn't been tested. Andy Lee is lower than Golovkin in the ratings, but yeah, Andy Lee has fought some of the best in the world at middleweight. There's a difference. Lee is battle tested, Golovkin is not. Let's hear what people are saying about this fight. If Diarmid says, Crawler got a lot of attention after being attacked, so Hearn is capitalizing it and hoping that it will, that with a title shot will generate a lot of money for Matchroom. Yeah, that's a valid point. Could be interesting there. But Michael Bird says, Frampton very publicly said now that he take 60-40 in his favor, will look very silly if Eddie makes the offer and Al steps in and advises against it. Okay. That's what Mark Benson says. Marky B says Lee's going to knock out Saunders. Matthew Wall feels the same. Henry Parker says Saunders can outbox Andy Lee. If him and Tibbs get the game plan right, I read if he can really do it. Yeah, he could outbox him. But Saunders fought nowhere near the level of opponent that Lee has fought. He's never fought anyone like Lee who can knock you out one shot at world level. And that's the problem there. I like Billy Joe Saunders. Billy Joe hasn't fought anywhere near the level of Andy Lee has fought. Billy Joe's in for a big shock, I reckon. I think so too. I really do. And I like Billy Joe's orders. Michael Bain says, I agree with UK boxing news. A small bit of ego and a large bit of Baron Wiggin has stopped the fight being made so far. That's between Frampton and Quigg. Marky B says, not in Ireland, he won't lose on points. No, I'm in Ireland at the moment. If you didn't know, I'm in the beautiful, rainy island at the moment. That's where this coverage is coming from. On that note, what happened to Eubank Jr.? He's gone missing from the sport. Yeah, I believe, like I said before, they pulled out the fight with Saunders because they were chasing a fight with Gennady Golovkin. Gennady Golovkin now is going off to fight Hopkins, I understand. So, and as you know, I do talk very well with his trainer, Abel Sanchez. Prawn Star Kilimana says, I think he'll get up the first time Lee lands. Second time, it's game over. But yeah, Marky B says, the level Lee has fought at, Saunders is in big trouble. I'd say that now. But we all thought that against Eubank Jr., remember? Yeah, but Eubank Jr., Saunders tired against Eubank Jr. Eubank Jr. was inexperienced, and Eubank Jr. is not world class, in my opinion. Not yet, anyway. Chris Jones says, that's exactly how I see the fight going. Billy Jones' tank empties after six rounds. Lee has proven that he's never out of a fight. He's got 12 rounds to find Billy Joe with something big. He has, and he will find him. Eubank Jr. wouldn't give up his shitty interim title in order to get the rematch with Saunders. Lost the respect for him because of that. Matthew Wall says, thought you were in Grenada, Ingram. Why did you move, Ingram? I've been in Ireland now since last year, August, and I'm with my wife here in Ireland, and change of life, basically. It's beautiful here. And, you know, I went to Grenada for 2 years to complete something I did at 14. I was coaching cricket, and I said my final stop would be in the Caribbean from 14 to 32, 34, and coaching from grassroots right up to that international level or national level, coach my country in the my island in the Caribbean. So I did that, and I thought that was the end of that. So I said, before you close one door, you should close one door before you open another. So I closed that door and I finished that coaching in the Caribbean, and now I'm in Ireland. So that's why. There's your answer. Ingram, what would have happened if Eubank Jr. fought GGG? Well, I asked Abel Sanchez that, and he thinks that Eubank Jr. makes too many mistakes, and he thinks that basically GGG would punish Eubank Jr. That's nice to know. He probably would, but the way William Monroe was throwing in punches, you got to say to yourself, at least Eubank would be in the fight. I don't know for how long he'd be in the fight. It's not so much what Eubank throws, is what's going to be coming back from GGG. That's my concern. And how GGG deals with that. What do we all think are the winners of Santa Cruz, Mares, and Rigondeaux, Lomachenko? Well, didn't Mares get... I'm sure Mara's got sparks in a round or two. I don't care about it. I mean, a lot of people talk about Mares and Rigondeaux, not Mares and Santa Cruz, and I don't give a damn. I honestly don't. I'm not excited about it. I'm really not. You know, don't ask me why, but I'd like after whoever wins out of those two actually fights, even Frampton or Quigg, or rigged out. That's what I'd like to see. So that's my thoughts on that. Rigondeaux, Lomachenko. There's expression, a good big man beats a good small man. And Rigondeaux is not just moving up in class and weight to fight a good champion. He's moving up to fight a guy who's equally as skilled as him or even better. Rigondeaux has proven that weight's not an issue. If you remember the guy, the last guy he fought who towered over him and dropped him, Rigondeaux got off the canvas to also drop his opponent as well. And it was a tough fight Rigondeaux came through. I don't know. It's a tough fight. But I would lean towards Lomachenko at the moment simply because Lomachenko is just as skilled as Rigondeaux, but the bigger man. So that's my story with that. Goes Matthew Wall continues. Ah, yes, I forgot about the cricket. England need help. LOL. International man of mystery. Yes, not just sport. I have a radio show as well I'm doing now, and a lot more other things I'm involved with as well. Santa Cruz is boring. I don't see the fuss about Santa Cruz. In fact, I don't see the fuss about Santa Cruz or Abner Morris. I don't personally. I just know that none of the guys have really done anything for me. So that's why I couldn't give a damn whoever wins that fight. Rigondeaux one I'm looking forward to after Mayweather, as well as Crawford. Yep, Crawford's the guy. I can see Crawford Pacquiao next year happening. Crawford doing what Oscar De La Hoya. What happened to Oscar De La Hoya and Pacquiao, the handing over the torch. I can see a similar thing between Pacquiao and Crawford, with Crawford beating Pacquiao in 2016 and the torch being on for Crawford to go on as Pacquiao did with De La Hoya. That's what I can see happen of Crawford in 2016. I could be wrong, but that's why I see it. I would love to see GGG versus or Gennady Golovkin against Andy Lee. I've been saying it for ages. The two fights I want to see Gennady fight. I don't want to see him fight Miguel Cotto. Or three fights I like to see. Or Danny Jacobs, he can stay to one side. Two guys I want him to see is Lemieux and Andy Lee. And until he fights those type of guys, I don't subscribe to GGG being the guy that he is. Sorry, I just don't. GGG has been hit flush by Gill and Monroe. Lee puts him down with a similar shot. Interesting. That's an interesting. If your claw clicker fingers and make one fight happen, what would it be? For me, if I could click my fingers tomorrow, Gennady Golovkin versus David Lemieux. That's the fight I'd want to see. That's a fight I'm interested in. That's the fight I'd be very interested to see. I think that's a great fight. A fight of interest, just of interest, not a click of a finger, but a fight I think that's going to happen, or I can sense happening at some point, is Bryant Jennings against Bermain Stiverne. I think that's a great fight. I really think that's a great fight between Stiverne and Jennings. A really great fight. I don't know who wins it, but I think it's a great fight. A great heavyweight matchup. Great heavyweight matchup. Wilder Fury. Yeah, I think so. Yeah. So tomorrow night, I don't know much about the other guy, but Lemieux can't handle the power. Well, GGG hasn't been hit on the chin the way Lemieux will hit him. So we'll find out whether GGG can handle power. Jennings Joshua. No, I don't want to see that. I'm not interested in that fight. I'm not really interested in that fight. I don't even know what I'm talking about. Okay, I think I'm coming to the end of the show here. Let me think what else I could tell you guys before I disappear. Don't forget to rate, subscribe, like, tell your friends, share the channel, share the news. Check out my recent interview with Romain Stavern. Look, guys, I do what I can to bring the interviews to you. And sometimes you do telephone interviews and, you know, no matter how much you try and test the quality and check the quality, the person on the other end of the line is muffling their words, or the other person on the end of the line isn't as clear or doesn't speak up very loud and doesn't shout down the telephone. Sometimes the quality is not as great as it can be. So, you know, I do try and bring you the interviews the best that I can. So I know people complain, oh, this is poor audio quality, but I can hear every word that's been said and they're able to hear what a fighter's trying to say. I'm not trying to say I'm Sky Sports or Ringside or any of those things, but I bring you the interviews that matter. Thank you for your support. I appreciate it. Don't forget to check out the videos, the interviews. Subscribe to Baylorick Boxing channel and subscribe to Baylorick TV. Hell of a lot of things are happening, you know, partnerships, collaborations, and a few new things will be happening on the channel shortly. Once again, we've done the crossovers. We're probably one of the first channels to do crossovers. And I like doing crossovers. I like visiting various boxing outlets. So far, I've visited 4C Sports Media. I have visited Boxing Gossip. I have spoken to Romain Stavern. I've spoken to Kevin Hooper. I've spoken to Charlene Jones, Tyson Fury, Peter Fury. This is of recent times. So yeah, we you know, going to try and get a hold of Brian Jennings whenever I can. Try and get you another interview with Terence Crawford. I'll try and chase that up as well. I've spoken to Terence in a long time. If you haven't, check out the two interviews I have done with Terence Crawford. I think both of them are about 20 to 30 minutes long. So some good interviews for you to listen there as well. Trying to get some new names on the channel as well. And I want to take things to a next level. Absolutely. Remember, next week, Tuesday, Fury, Klitschko, in Germany, the two big heavyweights are going to meet. My personal opinion, before I close off, is this. We may get the press conference. We may get the training. We may get all the workouts. But will we get the fight in October? And that is what I'm concerned of. I'm really concerned about that. Will the fight even happen? Will Klitschko pull up the fight of injury? John Rawling, yeah, well, I've talked to Mr. Rawling. He hasn't got back to me yet. So I have to contact him again and try and get him. I mean, myself and John get on well. I also want to talk to guys like Colin Hart and some other people I want to talk to as well. Surprise you guys with some different stuff. And check out the channel. There's going to be some new things happening on the channel. That's all I will say. Just keep close look. And I will say to you, remember, it was done first here on Baylorick TV. Okay, guys and girls, I'm out of here. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to rate, subscribe, leave your comments. And if you have anybody you'd like me to talk to, leave your comments in the comment section, the interviews that you want, and we'll see if we can chase them up. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you for tuning in tonight. Appreciate the love. This has been Ingram Jones from Baylorick Boxing Channel. I guess I'm out. Take care.